Give it up for the lovely ladies that you saw earlier. They were very well spoken, very necessary. This is such a welcome change from the elections and everything that's going on. You know, everyone's like, it's such a scary time to be Muslim right now, right? Except I grew up in Alabama, so it was never a good time to be Muslim or Arab. How many Muslims or Arabs do we have here? Whoa. Everyone's so polite, they're just raising their hand. It's still work hours. people loosen up. anyone from the South? A few people? I'm lucky I live in New York City now, though. I mean, like, I have a cousin that moved from, I'm also Palestinian, I have a cousin that moved from Palestine to Kentucky recently. Yeah, it gets worse. Her first name is Islam. Yeah, it's not even like she can go by like a nickname anymore, like ISIS or something. People always ask me, like, why did your parents move to Alabama out of all places, right? And I think it makes sense because they just needed to live in a place where cousins could get married, you know? So it seemed like a natural move. But people in the South or everywhere really freak out anytime that they hear any kind of Quran or anything. Because, like, we might hear, like, la ilaha illallah, and they hear a suicide attack, right? So I was thinking about this, and I think, like, people would be more inclined to listen to Quran if it sounded more like Christmas music, right? Because everyone loves Christmas music. So, like, instead of, like, la ilaha illallah, it'd be like, la ilaha illallah, la 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 la, right? And it just gets stuck in people's heads, and like, la ilaha, and there you have 3 million converts, right? That's all you have to do. But I try to be a good Muslim because I want to make it into heaven. So I'm just trying to be like good enough, you know, because I still want to have some fun. But as you guys might know, in Islam, there are several levels of heaven, right? There's several layers. And the more good that you do, the higher the level that you get into. So like the prophets are, of course, on like the highest level. And I'm not really an overachiever. Like, I'm not trying to get into, like, AP heaven. I just want to make it, like, barely by. I'll even do a summer in hell if I have to. When I lived in Alabama, my friends would always have to, like, prep their parents when they're meeting me, you know, so they wouldn't, like, be racist in front of me. They try to brace them. Like, this is Atheer. She's an Arab, like Jasmine from Aladdin. Just something harmless. One girl's like, I told my dad that you're a Muslim and he said it was okay. I'm like, that's fine, I'll take it. I've definitely heard worse. But it was hard for me to relate to my American friends growing up there because like my parents are conservative Arabs and I just didn't get my friends' problems, you know. Like in school, they'd be like, man, my parents won't let me date until I'm a sophomore. And I'm like, my parents won't let me date until I'm married, seriously. Or they'd come to school and be like, dude, I just got like really stoned last night. I'm like, oh my God, what did you do to piss your dad off? It's okay, you can laugh. That joke kills in Saudi Arabia, I guess. But believe it or not, this is not the career path that my parents chose for me. People are already laughing. Like, that's why I'm here at like 5 o'clock on a Tuesday. But like when I first started doing comedy, my mom called me up really frantically and she's like, Atheer, I haven't told your father yet you're doing the standing comedy. I don't know how to tell him. I was like, Mom, it's not a big deal. You know, I'm just telling jokes. It's not like I'm on stage stripping. She's like, I know that the theater strippers are making money. I guess she kind of had a point. But being like a typical Arab mother, like she wanted me to grow up and be a doctor, of course, right? And I actually went to school to be a nutritionist, but that wasn't like quite good enough for my mom. So she'd make my job sound way more important than it actually was. Like she literally introduced me to her friends once as a doctor of food. like, yeah, I'm right up there with Dr. Pepper. But like now that I'm a comedian, she doesn't do that anymore because she just stopped introducing me to anybody. But she's trying to do like the next best thing, which is marry me off to a doctor. You know, I'm almost 29, still not married. And but at this point, she just gave up on like, she doesn't care what kind of doctor either. He could be like a doctor of history or like a doctor of art or like Dr. Scholes. I'm kidding, guys. Obviously, she wouldn't let me marry a Jewish guy. But every year my family keeps reminding me that my biological clock is ticking. Like when they first saw that show, 16 and Pregnant, my family was like, oh, that poor girl, why did she wait so long? My friend is trying to convince me to join a dating site. She just got on blackpeoplemeet.com. You know, she thought it'd be like cool to date a black guy. But I would definitely join muslimpeoplemeet.com. Because I think it'd even be cooler to date an FBI agent. But even in New York, I actually get mistaken for Jewish a lot. So I have like Jewish grandmothers always trying to set me up with their grandkids. But nothing shuts that down faster than telling them, oh, I'm not from the Upper West Side. I'm actually from the Upper West Bank. Sorry. Whoops. Even my building manager, I live here in the city, and he keeps calling me Miss Yaakov, which is the Hebrew version of my last name, Yacoub. So he thinks that I'm Jewish or Israeli. And like, I don't want to come out and tell him that I'm actually Palestinian, right? Because it's like, I don't want to come home one day and find him living in my apartment. Next thing you know, he'll tell me apartment 22 never even existed. Thank you guys so much. Thank you, thank you. Thank you. You've been wonderful. Thank you. I'm now very excited to bring up your next comedian. He's a super hilarious guy. I'm sure you guys already know him. You've seen him on CNN. He's the co-producer of The Muslims Are Coming. He has his own show on Sirius FM. Please give it up for Dean Obeidallah.
Thank you. Have a nice round of applause for Atheer. Very funny. Hello, everybody. Assalamu alaikum. How's everybody doing? All right. I must say, this is earliest I've performed in a long time, but this is the best view I've ever performed in front of. Who's from the Ford Foundation? Who are the people? You've got to buy that building right there and get rid of it, because you have an even better view. This is beautiful. I'm sorry. I'm a simple guy from Jersey. So how was the whole day? Good? I learned a lot. I was here for about an hour. Very impressive. So how many people who are not Muslim, of other faiths? How many people of other faiths? All right. So did you enjoy it? Did you learn new things? Have you learned the word inshallah yet? Has anyone told you the word inshallah? The word inshallah means God willing or the will of God. It also can mean many things. It's a magical word to Muslims. It can mean maybe and no. And it's the most overused word ever. Even in situations God wouldn't care about. I was at a restaurant in Jordan, true story. I'm in Amman, Jordan. I asked the waiter, where's the bathroom? He goes, it is over there. I go, I'll be right back. He goes, inshallah. I'm like, what has happened in your bathroom that I need God's protection? Like, Habibi, let me hug you. So I'm originally from Jersey. Anybody from Jersey? Any Jersey people here? A few. We're a sad state. It's a hard thing. It's easier to get people to like Muslims than it is to get them to like New Jersey. That's... So I live here in New York City. It's a great city. It's a melting pot. Look at this room. It's diverse. This is the beauty of New York City is right here in this room. It's the beauty of America. Some people are freaking out. You guys know by 2040 or 2045, white people will be a minority in this country. Most white people don't care. Some white people freaking out. I have a pep talk for those people. There's a benefits to being a minority. You'll get your own month to celebrate your heritage, like Caucasian Awareness Month or Whitey Week, something like that. Celebrate the contributions of white people like Utah and Abercrombie and Fitch, crystal meth. stuff white people have made. I'm not anti-white, I'm just kidding with you. I'm half white, half not. I'm of mixed heritage. My dad's Palestinian, my mom's Italian. Anybody Italian heritage? Anybody? All right, we got a bunch. The rest of you, can you relate to being Italian? Have you been to the Olive Garden? Anyone? Want a tank top to a job interview? Just my mom's? So I know this is not a political event, but you're talking about Islamophobia, and one of the causes, frankly, are politicians. We know that. In the picture of the two young women from the New York Times, there was Donald Trump staring in the background. And he's running for czar, I think. This thing, he wants to ban Muslims from coming in America. First of all, it's ridiculous. Secondly, how do you enforce that? How do you know if somebody's a Muslim? Like at customs, will they have these subtle tests, like the bacon cheeseburger test, or will they put out food Muslims like shawarma or tandoori chicken, see if they stare at it? Or maybe it's much more subtle. They go, which way is Mecca? And if they point quickly, okay, you're out. Then we got Ben Carson. Horrible. Ben Carson said Obamacare is as bad as slavery. Obama, it's as bad as slavery. I didn't know slavery had a 24-hour customer support hotline. Like, are you kidding me? And he also said that we should not have a Muslim president. There'll be a Muslim president, my friends. Inshallah. God willing, there will be. But I hope it's, like, there's going to be one day. I know President Obama's not, as we know, but, you know, and I hope when we have a Muslim president, it's not like me. I hope it's like one of my cousins, like cooler guys, like open shirt, gold chains, smells like lamb a little bit. Comes out and says, everybody, President Mustafa Mahmoud Abu Sayyid al-Masri, but please call me Mike. I am so happy to be president, just like I promised during my campaign, half price in falafel every Friday. Now it gives me great pleasure to introduce my lovely first lady and my second lady and my third. Too many ladies. I did that joke in Saudi Arabia, like, of course, you should thank the ladies. Why wouldn't you not? That's really happening. I've done shows in Saudi. I've done shows across the Middle East. I've done shows in Egypt, Jordan, Dubai, Saudi twice. I've been there. What's the most promising thing is the young people there laugh at the exact same jokes that young people here of all different backgrounds laugh at. Because of YouTube and Facebook has brought the world closer together, which is great. They know far more about us than we know about them. They know our TV shows. They know our leaders. We don't know, almost, except for this room, most Americans don't know much about them. So it's promising. It's also culturally some differences, like anybody here smoke cigarettes? Anyone smoke cigarettes? Anyone left? No. I was in Jordan, everybody spoke. I went to a gym, there was an ashtray on a treadmill. It's like, I feel the burn, here and here, my friend. We have commercials to stop it from smoking, they have commercials like, don't be a quitter. So we have President Obama winding down less than 10 months. It's exciting. He's going to his first mosque tomorrow. I'm actually going right from here to Baltimore tonight. I'm going to be there, and I'm looking forward to hearing what he has to say. But who would want to be president? I mean, what a tough job. Obama gets attacked from the right and the left. He got attacked a year ago saying his cabinet wasn't racially diverse enough. Anybody know, though, when the first black person was appointed to a cabinet position in American history? Anyone have a guess? 1966. So for almost 200 years, every position, every cabinet photo, all white people. I swear, if I was Obama, last few months, making up for it, all black cabinet. Ladies and gentlemen, my Attorney General, Morgan Freeman. Not a lawyer, but he played God twice. That's pretty good. Secretary of State, Beyonce. Department of Agriculture, Snoop Dogg. Because he can grow stuff. Some people explain that to the other people. Homeland Security, O.J. Simpson. You need one scary person. Come on. So, and how many people here are born in other countries? How many? We have a lot of immigrants here? Wow. And how many are here legally? Keep your hands up. Legally? There's such an angry vitriol about immigrants in this campaign. Why can't we keep the undocumented immigrants and get rid of some of the Americans we don't like? How about that, folks? Put Donald Trump in a car and just kick him out at the border? How much fun would that be? Most of Fox News? Immigrants work hard. We work hard. Remember Hurricane Sandy? You guys lived that? Every American restaurant closed by me. What was open? Chinese restaurants. How do I know? I look at my window. There's a Chinese delivery guy on his bicycle delivering food because somebody ordered delivery during a Category 3 hurricane. Okay, I ordered delivery. Because he was there. Immigrants, my dad's an immigrant, work so much harder than I do. My fiance, I'm getting married, inshallah. I'm not sure, it's up to God. We will. She's an actress, she's an immigrant, works very hard. She's Arab, she's Palestinian. She was on the Broadway play, she was on Homeland. Even though she's Arab, they didn't make her play a terrorist, which is nice. She played the wife of a terrorist. You know, it's baby steps. It's a hard industry. And she does commercials and voiceovers. But there's one place in America she won't get hired simply because of who she is. Do you guys ever listen to relaxation tapes? You guys know what they are? Very calm music, very soothing. If you're stressed out, it says things like, breathe in, breathe out. You have nothing to worry about. Everything's going fine. That's soothing. But she has an Arabic accent. And Americans won't relax hearing, breathe in, breathe out. You have nothing to worry about. Everything's going according to plan. We need more Muslims in the TV, in the media. We need more and more. I mean, that's really, do you know what percentage of Americans have a Muslim friend? Does anybody know the percentage? There was a poll, I'm not making this up, there was a poll last year, like a year and a half ago, about 31% of Americans knew a Muslim. Then, like 4 months ago, a new poll came out, only 25% of Americans. Some people have defriended their Muslim friend. I'm not making those numbers up. If you don't know a Muslim and all you see is ISIS and Al-Qaeda on TV, are you not going to think the worst of Muslims? That's why we need this human counterbalance. That's why on my radio show, I begin every week by saying, I'm Dean Obeidallah and I want to be your Muslim friend. But we have to do more. We need the media. Like, I have some ideas. I want to see, like, a Muslim James Bond. This is my dream. Instead of coming out and saying, Bond, James Bond, he comes out, he goes, Abdullah. Abdullah, Abdullah. Maybe some Muslim versions of popular shows like Sex in the City, but we'll call it In the City because we can't talk about sex. Just four women shopping the whole time. Instead of Dancing with the Stars, we'll do Depka with Your Uncle. Scandal will just be called My Sister Had Coffee with a Guy. We'll call it Haram. So, what a great, I wish I came earlier in the day. You had some amazing panels and it was very inspirational. It was great stuff. All right, let me wrap up. It's almost time for the cocktail hour. Haram? Haram. Halal cocktail hour? What can I do? What can we talk about? Some jokes here. Can we talk about the jerks in ISIS? Is that possible? I think it's important we make fun of them as much as possible. Here's one thing. This is completely true. I wrote about this. I write for the Daily Beast. ISIS has banned people from wearing shirts with certain words on it. I'm not exaggerating. One was the word Nike, because it's an American product. Plus, in Arabic, it's a curse word if you pronounce it a different way. I'm not kidding. Here's the interesting thing. They ban people from wearing the shirt that says the word flirt or take me. Who is wearing a shirt that says take me in ISIS-controlled territory? I'm not making this up. Like, who's out there going, hey, ISIS, love your work. I'd like to go with you guys. But now ISIS, and I swear to you this is true, they have banned skinny jeans over the land they control. That's not for women. They force women to cover up. It's for men because some ISIS fighters were getting distracted by other ISIS guys in skinny jeans. The guys are, look, I'm fighting a holy war, but Bassam is beautiful. I cannot put the burqa on him. I can't. I have weird feelings. This is not right. This is true. This is the idiocy that we deal with. You read about this stuff. People say, oh my God. You know, people say, it's a challenging time. I think we're optimistic as Muslims. It's challenging. I think the challenge is the history of America. The great history of our country, we move forward. Like, there's anti-Semitism, it's been marginalized. Racism is marginalized to the big extent. Homophobia is marginalized. It's still there. It'll always be there. But we marginalize it where they're not on Fox News, racist and bigots. But anti-Muslim bigots, they get on TV. There's still two sides to anti-Muslim bigotry. That's the problem we live in right now. There's not two sides to anti-Semitism. There's not two sides to racism, not two sides to homophobia. So the dream is that, inshallah, we get to the point where culturally the norm has changed, where you cannot demonize Muslims and sell books and pay for that and get on TV and Fox News. So that's what we're fighting against all the time. And it's just, so, you know, I think for Muslims, some of us could use a hug. It's been a challenging time. You know, they say all press is good press. Take it from a Muslim. That's not true at all. A lot of bad stuff out there. It's just, it's countering all the negative things. And people have said things, try to be helpful. Like Katie Kirk said, we need a Muslim Cosby show. Which right now, not helpful. I don't Years ago, that may have been helpful, but right now, it's not the kind of show. That's the challenge. What are we gonna do? We gotta make friends, go out there, you know, deal with these crazy people, tell us we wanna impose Sharia law. And it's, you know, how do you deal with these? We're arguing against phantom menaces that they create, and that's the hardest thing. Like, we're arguing against whispers and shadows. They're not real things. And I'll leave it with a joke, but one serious. I wrote an article for Daily Beast coming out tomorrow about the right-wing people attacking President Obama for going to a mosque tomorrow. How dare he celebrate Muslims in this country? And I dealt with one of these, Pam Geller assistant, Rob Spencer, who have said to me all the time, they go, oh, you see, guys like CARE or these Muslim groups that are involved in terrorism. And my answer to them is always the same. Come with me to the FBI and produce your evidence. That's it. Because if someone's a terrorist group, I don't want them here. And the answer from people like Robert Spencer is like, I can't because the FBI has been infiltrated by the Muslim Brotherhood. How do you answer that? Like, how do you, that's just crazy talk. I'm like, how do you have that conversation? That's what the world I live in. Between comedy, this other world of like, I deal with people and it's, you can't believe you're having these conversations and they get paid to give speeches like that and they gin up the hate and then we see what happens. That's the world we live in. But, all right, so I'll leave you with this. This is kind of inside the ballpark for Arabs and Muslims, but I'll still do this joke for the rest. Like, you guys, did you have food today and everything? You did. See, you didn't have to pay for your food. Here's the biggest cultural divide between, I say, Americans, like white men, and four Arabs at a restaurant, and the check comes. Here's the biggest difference between the cultures. You give four white guys a check, everybody becomes a CPA. Everyone's like, Steve, you had French fries. I didn't have French fries. You pay for your... Bill, you had two sodas. I didn't have any. You're paying. You give four Arab guys, four Muslim guys a check, it becomes like throwing meat to a shark tank. They begin fighting. It's like, they fight. They're like, Habibi, 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 Habibi. Getting mad, like, you pay for this, I will never speak to you again, I swear to God. The guy goes, okay, you pay for this, I go home, I block you on Facebook, I'm not kidding. No Facebook, no Tinder, nothing, we never see each other again. And then finally, it gets to the point where Arab men actually say this expression. They go, you pay for this, I will divorce my wife. Do the non-Arabs know that Arab men actually use that expression? That's an actual expression, when Arab men say that, literally, I will divorce my wife. My question, has that ever happened? The guy goes something like, honey, you have to go. But Sam paid for lunch. I'm very sorry. I'll see you again, inshallah. Well, thank you guys very much. Thank you for inviting me. Good luck with your work. You're doing great work. I'm very happy to be here.